official members bounce, bust off the chrome, realize it's real hell where we call home.
Official members bounce, bust off the chrome, realize it's real hell where we call home.
From the heart inside one, I vision fat licks and mat clips. The chroma make the average imitator do backflips. You lack a pistol, so put a vest around the issue. Slugs will never miss you. Coming from members, that's official.
Glad you guys are here. It's funny turnout, because this is going to be the best data structure ever learned in computer science, right? Forget red black trees, right? Forget splay trees. Nobody uses that. B+Trees is what we want to use. So this is going to be the best. Before we get into that, again, everyone should be. Hopefully have started or finished project one. That's going to be due this Sunday coming up. We had the recitation on last Thursday. We also did a additional recording of how to profile the performance of your buffer pool. Guys, so profile the performance of your buffer pool so that if you want to get higher in the leaderboard, right, teach you how to do a flame graph. And if you've never seen how to use perf before, we have a tutorial on how to use that. And you can do this on either the command line or C line, or I think Visual Studio can also support it as well. Homework 3 will be released on the 25th. And then the midterm, although, you know, 3 weeks away, just at least put it on your radar, that's going to be in this room in class on October 9th, the Wednesday. And that'll cover everything up to, I think, lecture 10, including lecture 10. So whatever the Monday lecture is before the midterm, that will be in the midterm. Okay? We'll have more information about that next week. And then if you have any special accommodations you need us to handle, please email me sooner rather than later. Okay? Any questions about project one? Okay. Beyond this, again, we have some optional talks. The first one is actually today. It's gonna be on Zoom at 4:30 p.m. after class. And that'll be a project committer for data fusion. Somebody actually works at Influx. But InfluxDB will be talked later in the semester, but they're based entirely on data fusion. So Andrew Lim is going to talk about what data fusion is and why it matters and how you could build a more complex system on top of something like data fusion so that you have to learn all the things you're doing this semester, but then like you could build a more complex system on top of it. And then the following next week, we'll have the guy that actually invented data fusion. He's now Apple. He got bought out by Apple out of NVIDIA, and then he has a project called Data Fusion Comet. Basically, it's an accelerator for Spark, because Spark's in Java, Spark's old, and Spark's slow. Data Fusion Comet is a way to use Data Fusion to make Spark queries run faster. And then also in the week after that, or on Tuesday next week, we have somebody from Oracle, Tathankar, who is going to talk about how they support JSON in Oracle. Tathankar's a good dude. He's pretty high up at Oracle, a couple ticks below Larry Ellison. But he's a good dude, and it should be a good talk. And that'll be in 6501, but I think he's calling it over Zoom. It'll be pizza at that one. Okay? Again, these are optional. If you want to go beyond the course, these are the things I encourage you to check out. Because a couple of you asked me, how do I learn more databases other than me cramming as much as I can in the slides? These are opportunities to go beyond the things we've talked about. All right, so I know I said at Post on Piazza that we were sort of rushed at the end to go over extendable hashing and linear hashing, but we can talk about, I can answer any questions you may have at the end of today's lecture. But just as a reminder, that last class was about hash tables, which are these data structures that are mostly used in the inside of our database system to keep track of various things we need to keep track of while we're running queries and running transactions. We can use them as an index, but most of the indexes that when you call create index, the B+Tree that we're talking about today in most systems. Hash tables are nice because they have the average time complexity of 0-1, meaning you know you do a lookup on a key, you hash at some location, and that's going to be roughly where you need to be to find the key you're looking for, or that you identify that you don't need it. Like I said, most of these hash tables that we talked about last class will be primarily used for internal things inside a data system, not something you would normally expose to the outside world. Now, there are some data systems that are built entirely off of hash table, where the only thing you get is essentially a hash table. Roughly, Redis is basically that. All right, so now today's class, we want to go beyond this and say, okay, we talked a little bit about how hash tables can be used as indexes, and these are meant to be data structures that are going to allow us to find logical data, like tuples or records, in our databases more quickly. So we want to start to come to the background of what that is, and also understand filters, which we'll see next class, and then we'll talk about how, the next two lectures are how we're going to build optimized versions of these, or different data structures we could use. So an index as sort of be obvious to everyone here, is going to be a data structure that's going to be based on some subset of a table's attributes, like some subset of a column's, or all of them if you wanted to, but it doesn't have to be, where they're going to be organized and sorted in such a way that's going to allow us to do quick lookups to find single tuples. Now, it's not always the case. Sometimes you have indexes, like in Postgres, you can get blocks of tuples, right? But for our purposes today, we just assume like for a given key, we can find a small set of the table. An example of an index will be a B-tree, B+Tree. A filter is a data structure that can answer what are called set membership queries, meaning it can tell you whether a key exists in a set, but it can't tell you where it is, right? A B+Tree or an index will tell you, for a given key, here's where to go find it in my table. A filter says, for a given key, yeah, probabilistic. So it'll say, yes, I probably do have that key you're looking for, or no, I don't. And the best example, the most widely used one, is going to be a Bloom filter, which we'll cover in the last class. This is something you can, a filter you wouldn't declare on your table, although some data systems allow you to declare Bloom filter. You can declare Bloom filters on tables that can be used for query optimization. But in general, this is something like a hash table going to be used on the inside. Whereas a B+Tree is going to be something that we have to declare, like for an index that we have, that a human has to tell the data system we want this index. There's a whole other thing we'll talk about next week, where how do you actually keep these things synchronized and keep them thread safe or concurrent for concurrent access. Meaning, like if I update a table and I add a key, I want to make sure it appears in my index. So if I do a lookup on that index, I don't get a false negative. Again, that we'll cover throughout the semester. But to be back in your mind, you got to realize that like, if anything's in the table, I want it also reflected in my filter or my index to avoid, again, false negatives. All right, so today's class, we're going to focus entirely on B+Tree. We can teach an entire course on B+Trees, but I'll try to cover as much as I can, the basics within a single day. And then we'll start with the basics of it, different design choices we have to consider when we build our B+Tree in our database system, and then various optimizations we can employ to make these things run faster. And as a spoiler, Project 2 will be a B+Tree this year. Right, so it'll be based on the things that we talked about today. And B+Tree is the most widely used data structure in database systems. I was actually reading a blog article this morning from CeliaDB. They started with the red black tree, I don't know why, and then they realized that was a mistake, and of course they switched to a B+Tree. All right, so the confusing thing about B+Trees is that they're in a family of data structures called B-trees, but there is also a specific data structure call it a B-tree. And then sometimes people say for a database system, they'll say, yeah, we're using B-trees, but it's really a B+Tree. Like in Postgres, they say, yeah, we have B-trees, but as we'll talk about today, it's really B+Tree. And there is a distinction between not to be overly pedantic, there's a distinction what a B-tree is versus a B+Tree is, but most people implement B+Trees. But then most people don't implement B+Trees as it's originally defined back in the 70s, they use bits and pieces of various optimizations that people have developed over the years that we'll briefly cover. So the original B-tree paper goes back to 1970, and it's from Bayer and McCreight. McCreight's actually CMU alum. He got his PhD here in 1969, before any of us was born, or maybe even earlier. And then he went off to Boeing and built the B-tree with Bayer. But this is not the paper normally people read. There's a survey paper from 1979 out of IBM called the Ubiquitous B-Tree. And this basically describes, again, by 1979, this data structure was so widely known and employed in database systems. Like, that's why it was called ubiquitous, because it was essentially everywhere. And even though this is, nearly 50 years later, the B+Tree is still going to be the best data structure most of the times. Of course, we're going to tweak it for modern hardware and modern situations, but the core data structure is essentially the same. So there is no original B+Tree paper, right? There's a tech report from IBM in like 1973, I think, where they talk about different variants of the B-tree, and in it they include the B+Tree, which I'll find for you guys in a second. And then they also never define what the B stands for. Let me take a guess. He says balanced, huh? Balanced? Binary? No. Because binary means you can have only two keys, right? We're more generalized. What's that? He said author's initial, Bayer. That's another good choice. The other rumor is that it stands for Boeing, because they invented that Boeing, right? Well, so there's a very important follow-up paper that came out in 1981 on the B link tree. And this is actually written by someone here who did his PhD at CMU and is actually still at CMU. So Phil Lehman works in the dean's office on the fifth floor in Gates, right? And so we'll see what the B-link tree paper, does later on. They're basically going to add these sibling pointers. And this is what I was saying before, that like everyone says they're going to implement a B-tree, a B+Tree, but it's not the classic one that's been known. Everyone's going to use the sibling pointers from the B-link tree because it makes concurrent access more easier, right? And if you go actually look in the Postgres code, all the PDFs, you can click the links. So this will take you to a source code file. And sure enough, at the top of the file in the header, it says, this is a correct implementation, correct is always good, of Lehman and Yao's high concurrency B-tree management algorithm from the B-link tree paper, right? And so I asked, actually Phil sent me an email last week, because I mentioned him, oh yeah, we're teaching B+Trees again. And then he said he's 90% sure that back in the day, the Bayer McCreight guy, the B+Tree authors, told him it was named after Boeing. Right, it says the Boeing tree. Right? You know anything, why is Boeing building a database system? Again, back in the day, there wasn't off-the-shelf software like we have now. So if you're a plane manufacturer and you're trying to keep track of all your parts, you need a database system. One of IBM's first database systems, they built IMS. They built that to keep track of all the parts to build the rockets go to the moon. Right? And you can buy IMS today. All right, anyway, but B-tree, the original B-tree pair is from the 70s. Again, the B+Tree came later on, right? So what is the B+Tree? So it's going to be a self-balancing, ordered N-way tree that's going to support efficient searching, sequential access, insertion, deletions, all in log N time, right? And the M here factor is considered the fan out. So the number of branches or pointers coming out of the nodes corresponds to the fan out. And somebody said, oh, B stands for binary. So binary would be M equals 2, right? And that's only two, you know, well, yeah, so it's M equals 2. But like the fan out for a real database system, think of like hundreds of keys within a single node, right? Think of like, you know, we talk about 8 kilobyte pages in Postgres. How many pairs of 64-bit integers can you put in there? Quite a bit, right? So the fan out is going to be quite large, and that's going to make the height on average for most indexes, most B+Trees, 3, maybe 4, 5 is pretty extreme. So it's going to be pretty efficient for us to go find the data that we need. So the B+Tree, as it's classically defined, has these properties. It's going to be considered perfectly balanced, meaning every leaf node is going to be the same distance to the root, right? To get to the bottom layer, that's always going to be the same number of hops going back up, right? I mean, traversing down is always going to be the same cost, log n. And then every node other than the root will be at least half full. So the number of keys you have to have per node has to be greater than m2 minus 1 and then m minus 1, right? So I always need at least to have half the nodes full. And then when they get full, we have to deal with that. When they get less than half full, we have to deal with that. We'll see in a second. And so this data structure is going to be nice for us because we're going to be able to optimize ourselves or optimize the access patterns to handle reading large blocks of data and writing large blocks of data, which we said we wanted to do at the very beginning because sequential access is cheaper than random access. So we'll be able to design our data structure and take advantage of that. Now, the textbooks that define the textbook defined these properties. I'm telling you these properties, and we'll see throughout the lecture, real world implementations aren't always going to follow this. They're going to lack some of them. In fact, if I go back to the Postgres code here, right? If you can read the file path, it's source backend access NB tree readme. N means non, so it's non-balanced tree because they're going to break some of these requirements, and that's okay because it's going to allow them to get better performance. But let's understand the textbook definition, and we'll see how to break it later. All right, so here's a really simple example of a B+Tree. Right, in this case here, there's two keys per node, and so we have to first define what the node types are. So at the very top, we have the root node. That's the entry point for everybody coming into this data structure, into the tree. Then you have the parts in the middle, the inner nodes, sometimes called the non-leaf nodes, right? And then at the very bottom, we have the leaf nodes. So you can see, think of the bottom as being the leaf nodes is the all of the keys we could possibly have that are going to be in sorted order, either from lowest to highest or highest to lowest. You can define this when you if you want to create an index. So the contents of the root node and inner nodes, it's essentially alternating key value pairs where the key is going to be it's going to start off with a pointer to a node below it, followed by a key that represents the separation of the value or the key space. And then in the leaf nodes, we're going to have key value pairs where this is the actual data that we're trying to represent. Like for a given key, here's the value. And the value could be a pointer to a record ID, could be something else we're tracking in our system, right? So the way to think about the keys in the inner nodes and the root nodes, they're like separator barriers, a guidepost that tells you as you're traversing the tree, if you're looking for a particular key, whether you want to go left or right. So in this case here at the top, we have key 20. So that means all keys that are less than 20 will be to your left of it. And then all keys that are greater than or equal to 20 will be on the right of it. So if I'm looking now for a key, I could look at this at the very root, look at that 20 and decide whether I want to go left or right. And that tells me how to go down. And I just do the same operation when I go down below. Right? One additional thing we're going to have now is sibling pointers. So I think the original B+Tree implementation or the definition had sibling pointers at the bottom. It's just a way for us to get to left and right along the leaf nodes. What the B-Link tree paper added is sibling pointers for the inner nodes as well. And we'll see this later, when we do scans along the bottom, we obviously can traverse along these sibling pointers. The sibling pointers for the inner nodes are going to help us later on when we want to do concurrent access for splits and merge, because now we can jump across more easily without having to go back, always back up to the root. Yes?
If m is greater than 2, are there sibling pointers between every possible pair?
This question is, if m is greater than 2, are there sibling pointers between every possible pair? No, it'd be the sibling pointer would be for the node. Like for this node, his sibling is over there, okay. Right? So again, think of like large pages. It's not a record ID where you have to have the page number and the slot number. It's just a page number. So 64 bits or 32-bit integer. Not big. Yes?
But for the bottom row, if there's 3 children per node, is it just the left child pointing to the middle and the middle pointing to the right? Or do they all 3 point to each other?
His question is, if I'm the leaf node here, are the sibling pointers what? Sorry. Is
if there's 3 children in that same node, because you said there can be more than 2 children per node, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Do all 3 of them point at each other, or is it just the pairs?
It'd be going in lexicographical order.
Yes.
Yeah, so if you just like this guy, this is a 6, this is a 10. If there was a say 8 would be between in here, and this guy would only point to that. Right? Because again, what are we doing here? What is the leaf node? Or leaf nodes? What do they just look like? It's a linked list. That's all it is. Right? And so what the B+Tree is just the scaffolding above this that allows us to get to where we want in the linked list without having to do a sequential scan. Yes? This question is, there's no values for the inner nodes. The values would be the node pointers, right? So I should make this more clear. This, the scheme I'm showing at the top, right, for the root node, it's the same for the sibling nodes, for the inner nodes, right? There's pointers down to node, children nodes below it. Yes? It's a question, why am I showing 3 node pointers here? They would be null in this example. I'm just trying to show that like the layout would be node pointer key. And in this case, you only have 1 key, the rest is all null. And you keep track of the metadata to say how many entries you actually have, right? Or a null bitmap. So we'll see this again next class when we talk about skip lists. Skip lists is going to be basically the same thing where they have a linked list and they build crap on top of it, right? Again, once you understand, like, it really is just a linked list, but like, guideposts allow you to jump into that more quickly, then it changes your thinking about it. It becomes less exotic, in my opinion. All right, so we sort of already covered this. The nodes are to be comprised of an array of key value pairs, where again, depending on whether I'm a leaf node, inner node, or a root node, the values would either be pointers to other nodes, if I'm a root node or inner node, or a value that corresponds to the thing that I'm trying to map in my tree. Most of the time, the arrays will be sorted in key order. They don't have to be, but most implementations do that. For null values or null keys, you have to decide where to do that. And in most systems, you can either declare them at either the beginning or the end, right? Because you can't compare nulls with each other. You can't compare a null with keys. So you got to put them somewhere. You just put them at the beginning or the end. So one thing I also point out, too, is that going back here, notice how the children nodes don't store pointers to the parent nodes, right? And we'll cover this next class when we talk about how to make this thread safe. But the idea is that because now we can only traverse the tree in one data structure, sorry, in one direction, from the top to the bottom. You can go left and right, lateral moves. That complicates things. We'll talk about that next class. But in general, like, we're only going from the top to the bottom. Now we can't have deadlocks, because it's not like we have someone from the bottom trying to come up, right? Everyone's coming in always one direction. Again, the sibling nodes, sibling pointers will cause problems for us. Some systems will only have the linked list in one direction for the sibling pointers. So the same thing, you don't have deadlocks, so you can't have people coming in different directions. You always go one direction. Postgres has doubling linked list, but you don't have to. And it's a trade-off between, again, do you want to spend more time jumping into the tree to find the thing you're looking for, or can you just rely on those pointers? But now you got to maintain those pointers, and that causes other contention. So there's no free lunch. All right, so go further detail what the nodes actually look like. So as I said, there's a pointer for the previous page, the sibling, and the next sibling, and these are just page IDs, 64 bits or 32 bit ints. And then I just use my page directory we talked about before to go find the entry, the page that I want if I'm traversing along. And then we have these key value pairs that are just alternating one after another. All right, and the values are just going to be pointers or something. So the actual structure will look something like this. You actually have some metadata in the header that keeps track of, like, what level you are in the tree, so you know how to interpret what the contents are of the page, how many free slots you have, the previous and next pointer, other additional metadata, the null bitmaps, and so forth. And then you have the key value pair stored at the end, and that's just, think of like a struct or a pair of key followed by value over and over again. And in BusTub, it's set up this way. An alternative, and actually a better approach, is actually to do this, where you store the keys contiguously, one after another, and then have the value array stored that contiguously separately, one after another. Because then it's like almost like the column store we talked about before, because now I can rip through and do binary search or whatever I need to on the sort of keys more efficiently and not have to jump over pointers that I don't care about. Can you guys close the door? Sorry. Sorry, thanks. All right, so what are the values? So as I said, if it's going to be pointing to tuples, it's going to be the record IDs. Again, and most systems are going to do this, all right? And the record ID is just the page number and the offset or whatever additional metadata we need to jump to the things that we need. Right, this one's most common. But we talked about before about index organized storage, where the leaf nodes are actually where you could store the tuples themselves, right? SQLite and MySQL famously do this. For Oracle and SQL Server, you can optionally declare a table you want to be organized in this way. But for MySQL, at least in InnoDB and SQLite, always, like, when you create a table, it's going to be stored like this. All right, we discussed this before in lecture 4. So for the primary key index, the leaf nodes are just going to be the tuples themselves. If it's the secondary index, like a secondary key index, then the leaf node will typically contain the primary key of the tuple you're pointing to. So you do look up on the secondary index, get to the leaf node, now you have the primary key, then you do a second lookup in the primary key index to find the thing you're looking for, right? Because you can't use the record ID, sorry, you can't use a page number and an offset because the leaf nodes will start moving around, as we'll see when we rebalance the tree, and therefore you don't know exactly where the physical location could be. So if you store the primary key as the value, then you're guaranteed to be able to find it using the primary key index. This complicates other things. With MVCC, we'll cover this later in the semester. But again, most of the time, it's just going to be the record ID if we're using it as an index. All right, so I made a big deal that there's the B-tree and the B+tree. What's the actual difference? So in a B-tree, similar to like a red black tree and other trees you may be familiar with, the values are actually could be in the inner nodes themselves. Meaning as I traverse down, I'm not just trying to always get the leaf nodes, I could find an inner node, and actually the value I'm looking for, the key value pair, could be in that inner node, right? So this is gonna be more space efficient because each key can only appear once, and then if it gets deleted, then it won't appear anywhere in the tree at all. In the B+ tree, the values that we actually care about are only found in the leaf nodes, and the inner nodes are just guideposts to get us down to the bottom. That means we may end up deleting a key, and it'll get removed from the leaf node, but it could still exist in the inner node, because why pay the cost of going cleaning it up? It's just helping us get to the bottom. We can leave it there. Why do we care about this distinction? What's the key thing between a B tree and a B+ tree? If the leaf nodes only always have the values. Yes?
You wouldn't have to restructure the whole tree when you're deleting things.
He says you wouldn't have to restructure the whole tree when you're deleting things. You still might have to do that with a B+ tree. So you say, yeah, so you, so I'll just, let me rephrase what you're saying, but you're right. That if I do a traversal in a B+ tree, I get past all the inner nodes. Now I'm at the bottom. I never have to go back up, say for a scan. And that means I just rip across the bottom sequentially along the leaf nodes to find all the data I'm looking for. In a red black tree or a B tree, you gotta kind of bounce up and down the nodes to find all the things you're looking for. So this is gonna maximize the sequential access for us. Yes? Statement is you might put all the non-leaf nodes in memory. But you would still have, so his statement is, I think we're trying to say is like you could keep the inner nodes in memory and not just fast lookups, but then only fetch the things from disk or leaf, you know, evict things that are the leaf nodes that are maybe not likely to be used. You would get that anyway if it was a B tree, like if you're only accessing one side of the tree, then the buffer pool algorithm, the replacement policy will rip through, you know, replace those things as needed. Yes? Is why we want to do that?
Yeah.
We don't want to do that. That's what the B tree does.
Yep.
That's old. We don't want to do that. I mean, they're both old, but like, yeah, we don't want to do that. We want everything, all the values we care about are on the leaf nodes. So as he said, when I do want to look up a sequential scan or a range scan, I just traverse to the bottom, then I can scan along the leaf nodes sequentially, ideally, and just find all the things I'm looking for and never have to go back up the tree.
Would that approach benefit point query if I don't want to search with my range?
His statement is, would that benefit point query? To your point, yes. In a B tree, since the values may be in the inner nodes, yes, I may be lucky and the first thing, the root has the thing I'm looking for and I'm done, right? It'll complicate when we do updates, right? Because the red black tree, you have to do rotations. That makes all that harder. But the win we get for sequential access is going to be a huge game changer for us. Why we want to do this. Yes? So a statement said, I said that, oh, when we get to the leaf nodes, we'll be able to rip through things sequentially. But what if it just so happens that the pages themselves aren't contiguous and it becomes random? Well, because I know that when I'm creating the data structure and I'm allocating pages, I would know it's a leaf page, and therefore I should maybe allocate it to be larger than the inner node. We can change that, right? Or then also, too, I could pre-allocate pages to say, here's a bunch of leaf pages that are going to be contiguous to each other, and I make sure that they are logically contiguous and both physically contiguous. Yes?
Then how would you tune like the number of sorted keys in each node? Would it be based on like page size?
His question is, how would you tune the number of keys you want to have in a node? That'll come later. The answer is, again, it's a cop-out. I'm going to say many times to that cluster. It depends, but one of the key factors is actually going to be the hardware. If it's in memory, 512 bytes is probably enough. If it's a really slow disk, 1 megabyte. You can change that depending on what the hardware is. All right, so let's get through the actual how to maintain this thing, do inserts and deletes. But I think everyone understands the basics of how to do lookups. All right, so an insert, the idea is that we want to figure out, we traverse our data structure, the B+ tree, as if we're doing a lookup, right? That's the same algorithm. And then we find the leaf node where our key needs to be. So then if the leaf node we're going to insert into, if it has enough space, then we just insert it order, and we're done. But if it doesn't have enough space, then we have to split it. And we'll create a new node and take half the keys in the node that we're splitting and to put it on the new node, the new leaf node, and leave the other half there. And then we have to update our parent, which may recursively update the rest of the tree, depending on what the layout looks like, so that we can redistribute everything. Right? So that's a simple example here. So again, we have these guideposts here. And this is just saying that everything less than 4 is on this side, greater than equal to 4, and less than 12 is over here, and then greater than equal to 12 over there. We can use a more tight notation there. So if I want to insert 6, right, 6 should go here, right? Because 6 is between 5 and 9. But the problem is this node is full. So we're going to have to split it. So we'll just slide over that existing node, create a new node here, and then take half the keys that are in the one that we're splitting, keep half here, and put half over there, right? So I'll put 9 and 10 on this side, and then keep 5 here, and then now I can insert 6. All right? Am I done? What am I missing? Right, the inner node now needs to be updated to reflect that we now have a new split, right? So I got to put a value here. So all I'd have to do is just take the smallest value here, which is 9, promote it up there, and then this changes changes all the guideposts of what key range is covered by, what subtrees. So now if I want to insert 8, right? Again, let's start with the root. I use my guidepost to figure out where I need to go, right? 8 is less than 9, so it's going to go here, right? And I just insert 8, and that's fine. That's easy. Let's look at a larger tree, right? With more nodes per or more keys per node. So I want to insert 17, right? 17 is going to go here. That's fine, no issue. Now I want to insert 16. 16 is between 15 and 17, so it's going to go here. But now again, our node is full, where the new key should be. So I have to split it. So we'll do the same thing we did before. We're going to create a new leaf node, slide over the other guy. Split half of the keys to go stay here, half the keys go over there, like that. All right. Now I need to then make sure I update the parent node, so now it points to the new node I created. But the problem here is that the parent node is full. So I have this new parent guidepost up above in the root node. But I can't fit it into my current root node. So again, now I just recursively do the same thing I did before at the leaf nodes. I'm going to split the root node, put half the keys on one side, half the keys on the other side. All right? So but now I need to go decide, because it's the only node at this level, because it's the root node, I got to make another level above it. So I'm going to pick the middle point here, take 13. That's going to become the split point for the level above me. I take my create a new node here. Split the go back here. Sorry. Take 13 goes up. Now I can put 16, but now I need to update 13 I need to split this one further, right? So I split it now to two inner nodes. Half goes here, half goes there, and then now my root node points to the two inner nodes I created for the second level. Right? And the boundaries are this. So again, recursively keep going, do my splits until I meet my root. If my root is full, then I gotta split the root and make a new level above that, and then update everything down below. So because I don't have any parent pointers for these leaf nodes here, when I'm going back here, when I did this split here, right, I don't have to touch any of this side of the tree. Their parent changed because they're not pointing to it. That's no big deal, right? Now this new the new inner node here just has the pointers down below. Yes? Question, how do you know where to split? What do you mean? What do you mean by where? It's in the middle. Yeah, that's it. There's no magic to it. Okay. So delete is basically going to be the reverse of this. So same thing. I want to traverse the data structure until I find my leaf node that where I has the entry that I want to delete. If it's not there, then then it's negative. I don't do anything. If it is there, then when I remove it, if I become less than half full, then I have to merge it or do something to make sure that it's balanced. Right? So the trick we're going to do is we're going to rely on those sibling pointers to steal a key from our neighbor if we can, so that we become balanced. But if taking their, their key causes them to become unbalanced, then I have to merge. Right? Because if they're exactly half full and I'm exactly half full and I remove a key, and if it makes me less than half full, and if I take a key from them, they become less than half full, then I know I can combine the two. And I do the same thing I did in the insert. I recursively do merges up the tree until everything is balanced. So, yes?
So why do we want the tree to be at least half
full? Why do you want the node to be at least half full?
Yeah.
Because you want to make sure that looking up any key is asymptotically the same no matter what key it is. All right, and because it's sorted, the data structure will always end up being essentially the same no matter what the order we insert them, assuming we follow the same protocol, decide with the split key and so forth. This will be different than a try. Try's data structure is going to change depending on the order which we insert keys, but we'll ignore that for now. So again, this guarantees that any lookup for any key is always going to be log n. All right, so we're going to delete 6. Again, traverse the root down to the leaf node here. We go ahead and delete it. Now our this leaf node here becomes less than half full, right? So rather than merging, we just go look left and right, wherever we have sibling pointers, and find whether we have a neighbor that we can steal a key from. In this case here, the key next to it, or sorry, the node next to it has 3 keys, so we can go ahead and steal 9 without doing anything, right? But we're not done now, because now, since 9 was the guidepost here, right, we'd have to go look and peek and see whether that did we steal something, or actually we would know because that would always be above. So now we got to update the guidepost to reflect the fact that if any value is equal 9, should be over here. So all we got to do is just pop up the lowest value on this node here, which is 12, and then just overwrite it into its parent like that. That's easy. Let's see a more complicated example. So it's now going to delete 15 here, right? Do a traversal, end up in the leaf node, delete 15. Now this node is less than half full. So we can try to borrow from a sibling. That's fine. So we'll go ahead and copy 17 over here, right? And then now we just have to update the guidepost up above and say that 19 is the split, not 17. That's fine. That's easy. But now if I want to delete 19, I delete 19, do the reversal, find the leaf node, delete 19. Now I'm less than half full, but now I can't steal a value from any of my neighbors because they would also become less than half full as well. So I have to merge. And again, the different systems will do different things of like, do you merge from the left, do you merge from the right, do you steal from the left, steal from the right? The high level protocol is the same, right? Different systems do different things. In this case here, let's merge with our neighbor on the I guess our right, right? So that we all have to do is kill the guidepost up above, and then combine these now into a loot neath node. But now the parent node in the middle is now less than half full, and we need to then merge it with its neighbor or its sibling over there. So to do this, we're going to pull down the root node 13 and then split it across, and we'll combine everything together into a new root node. All right, so when you do delete, you may end up collapsing and reducing the height by at most by 1. Yes?
So to confirm for borrowing, are we only borrowing from like immediately adjacent siblings? Or like if there's something in the far left that has like 3, could we borrow all the way from over there?
So this question is like back here, when I had a borrow, is it only immediate siblings or could I do major surgery rebalancing things way over there? You could. Nobody, I don't think anybody does that. Could be expensive. Like you kind of want to be in and out of the tree as quickly as possible. And so spending time to go look at, oh, what could I steal from other than my neighbors, immediate neighbors, it just makes it longer and slower. Again, you're holding latches while you're in the data structure. We're not covering now, but just it'll slow everyone down behind you. Yes?
Just making sure, I think on one of the previous slides towards the beginning, you said like the max number of keys is M minus one, but M is like the number of children, so it could be completely cool, right?
Max number of keys is M minus one. So in this case here, you would have, there's four pointers, that's the degree, and then you have three keys. So the number of keys is M minus one, the number of pointers coming out is M.
Oh, okay, so M is the number of pointers.
Yes, okay. Yeah, or the degree of coming out, yes. So I'll double check the slides if that wasn't clear. All right, other questions about deletes? Yes. So going back here, why didn't I update from 19 to 20? Yeah, that might be a typo. Actually, no. All right, so good point. So the question is, going back here, I deleted 19, right? And then I decided to merge, and then I removed that guy there, but I didn't update the inner node. That's what I was saying before. If we delete a key, it definitely cannot exist in the leaf node, but it may exist in the root node. So in this example here, 19, well, yeah, that's discriminating enough. Like, it's still correct. Any value less than 19 is on this side. Any value greater than or equal to 19 is on that side. It's fine. Leave it alone. Right? You could clean it up, but there's no reason to. Right? It's still correct. And eventually, if we keep splitting the nodes, maybe it gets removed eventually. But who cares? It's still correct. In a B tree, you wouldn't have that. A B+Tree, you can. Yes?
So just to confirm, if for the inner node containing 5, 9, if we had a third number, let's say 12, and at this stage, would we steal that key from that node to put it in the second inner node?
So the question is, if I insert 12, so I would come down here, 12 is greater than or equal to 9, so it would go here. So it would fill.
Not insert. If 12, like if we had a third entry in that inner node.
Okay, so there already is a 12 here, yeah. And it points to something else, yes?
Would we have stolen it from that node to put it back to the other inner node? Or like, what would have happened to the delete example here?
All right, so his question is, if say I had another node in between here that had enough space that could steal a key, I think the rule is because you don't share a parent, you don't steal.
Okay.
Because if you do that, then you got to take latches on this, and it makes it more complicated. Yes?
So in deleting 19, why do we do a pull down instead of merging with
siblings? This question, in deleting 19, why would we do a pull down instead of merging the sibling? You could merge if you wanted to. But then it gets weird because now you have like root has one, there's at the top of the root, there's one node, and then the next level, there's one node. Right? So you would merge.
But that's theoretically still correct.
It's still theoretically correct. No, because actually, it would be more than log n because it'd be an extra jump to go find the thing you need. It's one, right? Which I said before, constants matter. So we don't want to do that. Yes?
So I think when you answer this question, what I understood was that all siblings on the final level will not be connected to each other. Like they'll only be connected if they share a parent. Is that true?
No, so I'm not sure on the sibling pointers here. Did I say that the sibling pointers only exist if you if you share a parent, no. You'd have sibling pointers all the way across, even if you don't share a parent. His example was, can I steal from a sibling where we don't share a parent? I would still have sibling pointers, but you would know who your parent is.
Then I would have to go to the, like, if I know who my parent is, then effectively I have to maintain a parent
this question is, yeah, I said before you would not maintain your, yeah, so this question is, how do you know that you don't have the same parent? That's a good question. Actually, I don't know what they do then. I'm pretty sure you definitely maintain something pointers all the way across. Yeah, I don't know how they check that. I mean, the most obvious thing would be you have to maintain the stack of the pointers as you go down. So you know that if for your parent to get down there, you were the leftmost child, there isn't anybody on the other side. So you don't go look. That's the easiest thing to do. Okay, one last question. Yes. Yes.
So what if you had a tree that was just like this, but there was a parent above the 13? Maybe we like insert things such that it like maintains those constraints. But then wouldn't this tree like have a shorter distance to the root than the other side?
I think the example you're saying, the same he brought up, where what if I had a single node above 13? So then that single node would only point to 13 and then the other side, or I'm not sure what you're saying. You can't do that. Like, it has to be balanced.
Right. So, well, this tree has shrunk in height. But in the case where...
Yeah, so we're here.
So if there was a case where this was more, we were looking at a subtree and that root was actually an inner node, would it be possible for us to end up with, one side of the tree
The question is it possible to have one side of the tree, subtree, have a shorter height than the other subtree? No, it has to be balanced. See, that case wouldn't happen. All right, last question, yes.
So the case where you pull down, you always check, if you have only one sibling, then you can, and, you have, just five nodes, then you always try and pull down each
turn? Your question is, do I always check whether I have one sibling, and therefore I can pull down?
How would you check whether you should pull down? Or should you always run that check before trying to do the merge?
So we'll come up with the next class. As you start doing the deletes, you actually keep track of latches on nodes where you know that you may have to do a merge. So you know how far up you may have to merge, as you get to the bottom. Because you don't, as you're traversing down, you don't know whether the delete the leaf node you're going to land on could absorb the delete without having to change everything, right? So you hold all the latches on everything, and then now when you do delete, you know how far up you would have to then apply the merge. Okay, there's a lot we need to cover. But again, it sounds like you guys have the basics of this, which is good. Again, we can go over this over a recitation for project one, or project two if necessary. Okay. I'm trying to think what's the most important thing to cover. Yeah, let's get through this quickly. All right, so in all my examples I've shown before, so far, we've talked about single key attributes, like a single digit, single value. But in actuality, you can have multiple keys for an index. And this is called a composite index. So in my example here, I could have a table called XXX, and I could make an index on attributes A, B, and C. Right, and I can declare additional metadata about what the structure of the data structure look like. So I can specify what the sort order is for a given column, and that can change. By default, it's always ascending. And then I also can specify where do I want to put my nulls? Do I put them always at first? Do I put them in the end? I think by default they're always at the end, at least in Postgres. And then now one of the things we can do in a B+tree, if we have a composite index, is we can do lookups on partial keys if we have a composite index. Remember I said we couldn't do this in a hash index. Hash index, you have to have all the keys because you take all the bytes and you have to hash it to figure out where you land in the hash table. So if you only have one of the two keys, the hash means nothing. But in B+tree, we can actually do lookups on portions of the key. So obviously, if I have index on A, B, and C, I can do where A equals 1, B equals 2, and C equals 3. But I can do a prefix lookup where A equals 1 and B equals 2 without having C. And then in some systems, I think only Oracle and SQL Server, you can do crazy stuff like just the inner parts of the key without actually having the prefix, like, you know, B equals 2 and C equals whatever, right? So visually it looks like this. So again, say I have in my composite index, I have two keys, 1 and 2, or sorry, two values. So I want to look up a key where the pair 1, 2, again, I just break out the individual components of the attribute because I know the type of the keys because I'm storing that in my catalog because we're a relational system. So then I just do my lookups as if I was looking up on a single key, decide where I want to go down on my tree to find the data that I want. If I want to do a prefix lookup, it's essentially like having a wildcard at the end of the key. Again, think of the keys as just a byte array, but I know where the offsets are. I know how to jump to the individual types. So if I only have the A and the first key and not the second, again, I just treat that as doing the lookup on the first part, land down in my leaf node. Now I scan along, thanks to sibling pointers, to find the keys, find the rest of the keys that match the predicate that I want. The last one is a bit more complicated. And again, only Oracle and SQL Server do this, right? So now if I only have part of the key, again, now I basically have parallel searches going down all possible branches in the tree, right? Now you just have multiple threads, you got to coordinate that of who's looking at what and so forth. And then you find all the matches, and then you have a way to consolidate the results later on. Oracle calls these skip scans. I'm pretty sure they have a patent because it's Oracle, right? And that's why most systems don't implement. There's a lot more machinery you need to handle this. Now we need to handle duplicate keys. Right, I said before, you can have a primary key index where the key has to be unique, but then you could also have secondary key indexes where it may not be unique. Right? Like people would have multiple people are gonna live in the same zip code, and if I want to index on zip code, I have to be able to handle that. So there's two ways we can implement this. The most common one is that we actually implicitly store as part of the key of the index the record ID. And then going back to what I just showed about the composite index, if now I want to do a lookup on someone's zip code, I just do the prefix lookup, just with that zip code, it's going to find all the entries that with the same zip code, even though I don't have the second part. I don't have the record ID. And then now the data system the B+Tree implementation just treats all the keys as unique, because they are. Alternative is to do overflow leaf nodes, and this is where I recognize that I have duplicate keys, and I just allow leaf pages to keep almost like the chain hash table I showed before, just keep having more pages appended to the end of it, right? Which sucks because if I have a skew distribution, I may end up with a really long chain, and I'm back to doing sequential scans. So for appending the record ID, again, the key, even though I'm showing the key is like 1, 3, 6, 7, the key really is like this hidden thing where they're keeping track of the record ID, all right? Postgres does this, but I don't think they even expose to you. You can't get through SQL that it's storing the record ID. Only if you look at the page, the actual bytes, you can see that. So when my SQL query wants to insert 6, what it's really doing is first inserting the tuple into a page. Now I have a record ID with a page number and a slot number, and then concatenating that to the key, I do my insert and I land exactly where I want. And now in this case here, because there's already a 6 or some other record ID, I just do the split algorithm that we just talked about, right, to add new leaf nodes. So again, logically it looks like it's the same key, but physically the record ID is in there. For overflow leaf nodes, the idea is that you would recognize that I already have the key that I'm trying to insert in my leaf page, so then I just extend it out to add another leaf page and have a pointer down below, and so forth. Yes? His question is, do we just say that the value is also the record ID as well? Yes. So if you're smart, you could just recognize, oh, the record ID that I already have in the key is the value as well, and don't store it twice. I don't know what Postgres does. Yes?
Don't the overflow nodes break the sequence
order? Absolutely, yes. Yeah, so his statement is correct. Doesn't having these overflow nodes break what we just said before about having sequential scan along the leaf nodes? Absolutely, yes. I mean, in some ways, you sequential scan this way, then you have the node to pop back up, but yeah. And as I said, if you insert the same key over and over again, now you have this really long overflow chain. And that sucks. It's more management. Yes?
How do we search a key that has duplicate? Do we search it like, as if it's a composite index?
His question is, how do you search a key when you have duplicates? If it's the record ID, then it's just prefix search. Yeah. So I have the six. I need to find the six, but I don't know what the record ID that's appended to it. So I'll get all of the sixes and get all the record IDs out of that. If it's the overflow chain, you land to the leaf node and you say, all right, well, I know the key I'm looking for has to be in this leaf node. So let me follow all, you know, all the overflow pointers down below. And when I'm done, then I know that six can't exist in any other pages. It's the same thing as the chain hash table, right? So in the chain hash table, you hash it, you get a bucket pointer, you land that bucket chain, and you scan all those pages until you find what you want. Same thing, but instead of having a hash, the hash lookup at the top, it's a B+tree. Yes?
Consistent lookup time.
And she's correct. Doesn't this break the log n guarantee? Yes. You know what? I should put the thing here. Don't do this. Do the record ID one. Okay. I just want to show you that you could do it. There's another, you know, one way you could do this. But don't. All right. Clustered index is an interesting concept in data systems. And as you said, like if we're using a heap file storage, the heaps are unsorted. Right. But now I'm maintaining this heap data structure that's unsorted, but I also have this index that's unsorted, right? And I can do index and organized storage where everything's nicely sorted in my leaf pages. But in some database systems, you can actually say, I want my heap file to actually be sorted based on some index. And when you, in Postgres, you can call the cluster command, give it an index on a table, and it'll literally rewrite the table to be sorted based on that index. It won't maintain it forever. Right? If you start inserting new things, it'll become out of order, but it's sort of like a one-shot, one-time operation. Right? And again, the reason why this matters is because, again, we want to maximize the amount of sequential access we have when we're accessing our table. So if we have a cluster B+tree, again, whether it's one-time sorting like in Postgres or in index-organized pages, if now I want to scan along the leaf nodes find all the table pages, when I access the pages, I know that I'm only going to retrieve them once, right? Because there's no value that could be in, you know, the key that points in here that could potentially also exist in here. As I scan along, I have to visit each leaf page once, right? If it's unsorted, though, the index is now going to be sorted on some sort order, and then now my heap file or whatever the pages are, they're completely unsorted entirely. Right, so now if I scan along here, my pointers may be going all over the pages. So what happens now? Now if I'm just blindly scanning through whatever I see that comes out of my index and then go grabbing the page, I'm going to have random access. Say we have a really extreme case where we only have one frame in our buffer pool. So just using this example here, so this little box here represents every single time I have to go read a page that isn't going to be in the buffer pool. And so rarely do I have two pages that are, or two keys that are pointing to the same page contiguous to each other. So I'm basically thrashing, going in and out of the buffer pool, going at pages over and over again. So really simple optimization is to not actually fetch any tuples while we're scanning the index. Just go get the list of tuples we want. Then sort them based on the page ID. Now when I scan through and get all the tuples, I'm only retrieving each page once. Right. Postgres calls this, I think, a bitmap heap scan. Right? It'll do a scan on the index, get all the pages, sort them, and then combine them together. Right? In some cases, also, too, you can actually do this. You can get all the page IDs from multiple indexes, then do intersections on them, depending on what the where clause is. And then now you just have a single list of the pages you need to retrieve. All right, I want to finish up in the last 20 minutes talking about some optimizations we could do. And how we actually want to build this thing. So some of these ideas and techniques are going to come from this book that came out about 10 years ago called Modern B-Tree Techniques. So again, the B+Tree paper is 1970, B-Link is 1981, but they're still writing books about how to make these things work because it's the most important data structure in the world, not just in databases, right? Think how crazy it is. There's a data structure for databases people write a book about, right? There's no book on red-black trees. As far as I know, there's no book on splay trees. No offense to Danny Slater, right? It's so important. There's a follow-up that just came out last month, right? More modern B+tree techniques, right? So again, it really is that important. All right, so the first question is what he brought up. Like, how do we decide what the size of our node's going to be? And as I said, like, it's going to be based on what the hardware is. So the slower your device, the larger you want your page size to be for your nodes, because when I have to go fetch it, I want to maximize sequential access. So if it's a really slow disk, 1 megabyte, if not larger, but it's really fast, 512 bytes is actually the right size. So the enterprise systems like DB2, as we talked about when we talked about buffer pools, you actually can declare for a given index what buffer pool manager you want to use for. You can instantiate different buffer pool managers, and you can specify what size the pages should be. So you can say for this index, it's on this buffer pool manager with this page size, again, depending on what you want. And if you know that you're mostly doing point queries, going to look up single keys, maybe you want a different size versus doing long scans. The next question is, what should be the merge threshold is? As I said in the beginning, there's the textbook definition that says, I merge when I'm less than half full. But it may be the case that you're like deleting and inserting really fast over and over again. So all you're gonna end up doing is just splitting and merging over and over again, like insert a key, delete a key, insert a key, delete. And to avoid that, you can relax that constraint to let something go less than half full so that you're not collapsing that node. If some inserts show up, then you can fill it in. If it goes completely empty, then yeah, merge it, right? All right, this is why Postgres, again, they call it a non-balanced B+Tree in the code, because it's not exactly balanced as the way we talked about before. Another trick you can also do is you can have different sizes for the leaf nodes than the inner nodes, right? Typically want maybe the inner nodes to be a bit larger than the leaf nodes, all right? Because they're going to see most of the traffic. Next thing we got to handle is variable length keys. So there's a bunch of ways to do this. One way is, instead of storing the long keys inside the pages of the nodes themselves, you just have a pointer to the tuple, like a record ID to the pointer. And then, since we already know how to store those in slotted pages, we just use all that. So in memory databases, there was a data structure called T-trees. I think T stands for the name of the dude that invented it. But if you look at the paper, all the nodes look like T's themselves, right? So that was a nice little clever thing that they did. Do we think it's a good idea or a bad idea? He said depends. I mean, yeah, he's yes. Like if your keys are like 1 gigabyte, sure, that yeah, definitely. But most keys are not 1 gigabyte. What do I have to do a lookup? I got to go look in a node before I can do any comparison of the key. If there's no keys in the nodes, I got to get a record ID to go follow that pointer to get that tuple. Then I compare the key. So as I'm traversing down, even though if I'm doing binary search, the minimum amount of search we have to do within the inner nodes of a B+Tree, I got to go fetch a bunch of tuples, and that sucks. So most systems don't do this. Even the in-memory systems like Oracle x10, which originally was using T-trees from the 1990s, they got off of this, and everyone's using B+Trees now. You can have variable length nodes, right? You can allow a node to, the size of a node doesn't always have to be fixed within a given level. This is only in academic systems. It's pretty rare because it's a lot more memory managed to do this, right? The right approach would be something like again, DB2. You say the buffer pool has this page size and everything inside is the same. You can do padding that we talked about. If I know the max length of the key type, then I put a bunch of zeros, empty space after the key so that it always nicely aligns. The more common approach is just within the page of the node themselves, just like we had that slotted array. Slotted pages, you have a portion of the space where you store the variable length keys. And in some cases, you could have overflow, right? And Postgres allows overflow within a given node to accommodate this, because you want the number of keys has to be fixed. Next question is, okay, when we land in a node, how do we do that search to decide whether we want to go left or right? So the easiest thing to do is just linear search, right? Assuming that it's not sorted, I start from the beginning to the end, just scan along till I find the key that I want, and I'm done. And, you know, it's simple to do, it's easy. A better way to do this, though, if I could take advantage of modern hardware, is to rely on SIMD. Does everyone know what SIMD is? Who here has taken 418? Very few. Okay. Does anyone not know what SIMD is? Single instruction, multiple data. So in sort of classical programming, you think of SISD, or like single instruction, single data, like 1 plus 1 equals 2. That's SISD. Right? You can take one, put it in the register, take one, put it in another register, single instruction, and it gives you 2. With SIMD, you can rely on the hardware to allow you to take a vector of values, and then there's specialized vectorized instructions that do same operation on all the values within that vector. So we'd use like intrinsics like this for x86. ARM has their own version of this, right? And there's libraries that can do this all for you. But let's say I'm looking for 8. So I'll put in my vector register 8 4 times, because these are 4 lanes in here, right? Assuming 32-bit integers. And then now, within a single instruction, I can do a comparison with a vector of 4 values that I'm looking for, and it just gives me another output register that says 0, 1, whether I have a match. So instead of doing that, yes, I'm doing linear scan, looking at individual values, but within a single instruction, I look at 4 values. Or you go up to AVX 512, I could look at, you know, significantly more. And then if I don't have a match, I just scan along and do the same thing again until I find the thing that I want. And there's bit shifting operations to pull out the one and identify where it was. Right, so that'll speed things up. That's nice. Obviously, again, if it is sorted, then we can just do binary search, right? You just jump to the middle point, look at the key, figure out when you go left and right, and you just can jump around until you find the thing that you're looking for. All right? That's straightforward. The fastest way to do this, which is only exists in academic papers, I don't think anybody actually implements this, is through interpolation. So if you know that the keys don't have any missing values in them, they're always monotonically increasing, then you can just do a simple formula to say, I know that the key has to exist or not exist, therefore, I know how to just do the math to jump to the offset that has exactly what I want. Again, like I said, no systems actually do this. It's going to be binary search or the linear search with a SIMD is going to be the better way to go. All right, so let me run through quickly last set of operations or optimizations you can do. So prefix impression is when you recognize that because the value domain within the index are going to be, the values that contiguous each other are likely to be very similar. Same reason why we put things as a column store, that now instead of having dispersed values from different attributes within a table, it's all the values for a single attribute are contiguous. So if I recognize that I've seen the same thing over and over again, the same prefix, then rather than storing that redundant information, I just store the prefix separately, and then everything else that comes after that is the suffix. So now when I'm doing lookups, I know how to look at the prefix as needed, and then only look at the remaining suffixes if I don't have a match. It's sort of like the delta compression that we talked about before, like the frame of reference compression. For deduplication, the idea is that if I can recognize that I'm seeing the same key over and over again, instead of having to store that key redundantly, I can just have the key once, followed by maybe a small number that says, here's how many values that are going to occur for it, and then followed by those values. All right? Postgres added this 2 years ago for their B+Trees, and it reduces the size quite significantly. Right? You can actually do the same things for the values as well, not just the keys. Like if I have a bunch of tuples that are all on the same page, instead of storing the same page over and over again, I just store it once, say all these guys are in the same page with different slot numbers. Why would there be duplicate keys?
Yeah.
Zip code. Right, the zip code example.
But don't you say we need to add a record ID to
this? So he's correct. Like, didn't I say you would have the record ID to make sure it's unique? So the key's the same, the record IDs are different, right? So
is the record ID not part of the key?
But I'm saying, like, in the internals of the system, we could say, I know I'm appending the record ID, and therefore, if I see the same key, the same prefix of the key, store that once, and then now I just have the record IDs, and that's the values. So up above in the inner nodes, and I think in Postgres, up above the inner nodes, I think you don't do the deduplication, but for the leaf nodes, you could do this. All right, yes.
Should I go back? Oh, yeah. Is this like a better form of the overflow nodes just because it doesn't add like extra layers?
She said, is this a better form of the overflow node because those are extra layers. Yes, but like you still may have to have the, if you're doing the overflow method, you may still have to have the overflow chain. All right. Again, always thinking like extreme examples. I have a billion people. There's a, you know, half a billion people in one zip code.
So is this also a bad idea?
No. So question, is this a bad idea? This is a good idea. Because you could do this for the record ID thing that I talked about before, right? Appending the record ID. Because now I can extract out, say this is actually the key here is the true discriminator, the thing I care about, like the zip code. And that's getting repeated. But then the I'm putting the record ID as part of that composite key. I pull that out. That's essentially the value. Now I'm sorting zip code once for all possible values within that zip code. This is a win. You definitely want this. All right. I can do suffix truncation for the inner nodes. Again, if I recognize that most of the time I only need, or the keys and the inner nodes are pretty unique, at least for certain number of characters, say for a string, then I don't need the rest of the string to figure out whether I need to go left or right. So say I have long strings like here, right? It's the full alphabet. But I only really need the first letter to figure out whether I need to go left or right. I'm showing three letters. So I just store that instead of the full thing. And then now that's enough for me to figure out when I go left or right. Now, of course, this may break if someone inserts something that violates this. So that's why I'm storing ABC instead of just A. I'm giving myself a little wiggle room in case something comes along that could have to go left or right or go in between. But again, I can get away with this because the B+tree doesn't store the actual key values, the true key values in the inner nodes. So I can store whatever I want in there. As long as I'm going left or right correctly, I don't have to have exactly the key that I had before. Yes?
But over time, wouldn't the minimum prefix required be different?
Yeah.
So the question
is, he's correct. Like over time, wouldn't the minimum prefix be different? We'd have to change that. I just update it, right? Again, we'll talk about latching next class, but like I'm holding the, if I need to update an inner node, I'm implicitly latching the children nodes because no one can get to the children unless they come through me. So therefore I can do whatever change I want. All right, this last one is super important, pointer swizzling, where this is actually gonna break sort of the nice abstraction layers we had in our database system about page IDs and record IDs and actually store raw memory pointers. So if you think about what happens when you do a lookup on a B+tree? So I start with the root, I find key 3, and I got to figure out when I'm going to go left and right. So when I'm at the root node, I again do that comparison. I need to go down this side here. But again, I have a what is it really? It's the page ID. So I got to go now to the bar pole and say, hey, I want page 2. Bring that into memory and give me the raw memory pointer in my address space where I go access it. And then now say I get down to the bottom, the leaf node here, now I'm doing scan along, if I gotta follow the sibling pointer, same thing, I need to know what the real memory address is for a given logical page ID. I go to my buffer pool and ask again. So I'm doing this over and over again, I'm asking for this mapping from page IDs to physical memory addresses over and over again, and that's gonna cause a bottleneck in my buffer pool. So if you recognize that some pages are hot, and you're always going back and asking the buffer pool where it actually is, you do what is called pointer swizzling, where you actually store the raw memory pointer in the page so that when you do that traversal, you don't have to go to the buffer pool manager. So obviously, you would want to do this for the root, right? Because everyone, you can't go into that structure unless you go through the root, so store that memory pointer somewhere. And then you could do this maybe for the hot pages like the inner nodes. You need to be careful about this because we're actually storing that memory address in the page itself because it's in memory. We got to keep it pinned. And obviously, we need to keep track of that when I flush it and write it out to disk, that I don't write out the memory address because when I bring that back in, that memory address could be completely garbage. So a little more bookkeeping we have to do here, but we're avoiding having to do that extra lookup to have to go to the buffer manager. And obviously, I need to know that I swizzled a pointer and there may be different pages pointing to my memory address. So I don't want to evict that memory address without telling everyone else that it's being evicted. So you typically arrange this in a sort of hierarchical manner that you can't evict anything you can't evict anything unless its parent has been evicted as well. Like there's it's a bit more complicated. But this is a huge win. We can do this for other data structures or other parts of the data system as well. All right, the last one to talk about is do bulk inserts. So in some cases, you may actually know all the keys ahead of time. Right? So if I load my table, typically people tell you, unless it's a unique constraint where you make sure you don't have any, you know, integrity violations, you actually want to remove all the indexes in your table first, then bulk load all the data, then call create indexes. Right? Because if you incrementally update indexes, that's going to be much slower than calling create index, because you can actually do that in parallel. So if you know all the keys ahead of time, what you want to do is pre-sort them, and then now just fill out your leaf nodes with your beautiful sibling pointers. And then now, you, instead of building the index from top down, you build it from bottom up. You build basically the house on top of the foundation here. And in some cases, too, if you recognize that, oh, this is rarely ever going to be updated, I don't have to keep it half full or keep some extra space. I just completely fill it up entirely, have these pages completely packed. Then now my data structure is the most compact that it can be. Right? So you'll see this when we... you'll see this in some cases when we run queries. In some database systems, they'll actually build the index, build a B+Tree for you to run your query, and then immediately throw it away. In that case, they'll sort the data, then build the index, then use it for that query, and then throw it away. Because it's faster to build the index and use it to run the query versus doing the sequential scan. All right. Actually, I lied. There's one more optimization I want to show you. And it's related to the log structure stuff we talked about before. So, as I just said, maintaining the B+Tree is expensive if you're doing sort of incrementally because you have to do these splits and merges, right? And the worst case scenario could be for one insert, I got to basically have to rebalance the whole thing, right? So what if there was a way that we could absorb the updates to our B+Tree and then only apply them in a batch when we know we absolutely have to? So this is called a write-optimized B+Tree. The Wikipedia article calls them fractal trees. There was a guy out of Stony Brook that invented this. Sometimes it's also called B-epsilon trees. And it's going to look a lot like the log structure merge tree that we talked about before, where you have this buffer where you're doing a bunch of writes and absorb that and then only spill down below when you have to. Or we saw the same technique before when we talked about MySQL compression scheme, because they had this mod log in front of every page where you do a bunch of inserts without having to decompress everything. So this concept of log structure is super important, and we use it for all throughout in our data system. So in a B-epsilon tree or a fractal tree, we're going to have a mod log for every node. So now when we do an insert, we just write it into the mod log if we have space without doing that full traversal down to the leaf nodes, right? Because now that's fast, right? Like we said before, the log structure merge tree was super fast. It just append to the log in the mem table and never have to write out the disk. So now if I want to do a delete, same thing, delete 10, I put it in my mod log here at the top, and I don't actually go to the bottom and actually delete it. Right? Because the idea is that now if anybody wants to do a lookup, they're going to start from the top of the top root node, and they got to look in the mod log to see whether the thing they're looking for has been inserted or deleted accordingly. And then if it's not in there, then they do the left-right traversal that we normally do in a B+Tree. Right? So actually going back here, they're looking for 10, so I would find the delete record in mod log for 10 at the very top, even though it's still hanging out in the bottom, it's actually in my physical data structure, but logically it's been deleted because I have a log entry for it, so I can go ahead and stop right there and I'm done. And the reason why it's called a fractal tree, because now when we run out of space in our mod log, then we sort of apply, or we're pushing things down accordingly. So in this case here, if I want to insert 40, I don't have any more space in my mod log, so I got to take my entries that are in the mod log of above and push those down so I can put the insert into 40 here. And then now you're doing the split left and right. You're actually looking at the thing that you modified and deciding should that mod log entry get pushed down the left or pushed down the right. So in this case here, 7 and 10 are less than 20, so it should go down here. But then it gets absorbed by the mod log guy below. Now this guy was full, then this thing gets applied recursively down below. But again, the idea is that you can do fast updates, and it has all the same complications of the log structure stuff that we saw before. So I said before, the guy that invented out of Stony Brook, they had a system called Tokutech, and this TokuDB was based entirely out of the fractal trees. That got acquired by Percona, and then I think it was called ExtraDB for MySQL for a while, but that eventually died. The STSDB was a thing out of China. I think that's dead too, but the probably the most famous one that's using B+Trees now is SplinterDB out of VMware. And then Relational AI, who we had speak last class, they don't heavily advertise it. And then there's a new system out of China called ChromoDB that claims they're also using B+Trees. So it's way more complicated than a B+Tree because you have to maintain these mod logs and apply them and so forth. But again, for write heavy workloads, this would be much faster than a regular B+Tree. Yes? When would you actually apply the log? So when you get to the leaf nodes. So if this thing had to spill down, I would come down here, I would insert 7, and then delete 10. And then say, in this case here, I'm now less than half full, I would then go through the normal B+Tree protocol to rebalance. All right, so the venerable B+Tree, despite being 50 years old, is widely used, and it was always the right choice for any database system. And then you sprinkle in the stuff from the B-link tree that we talked about, and the other optimizations, and that makes it makes it be able to handle anything. And this should be, if you're building a new system from scratch, this should be the first choice. Right? I don't care what you read on Hacker News about skip lists, they're terrible, right? Tries are interesting, but you put tries inside of your B+Trees, we'll talk about it next class. B+Tree is almost always gonna be the right choice for any database system, if you wanna do this kind of point query access. So next class, we'll see how much we can get through, but I'm gonna cover a bunch of different other data structures that are out there. Skip list, we'll say why it's a bad idea. We'll talk about bloom filters, tries, skip list, inverted indexes, and we'll finish up quickly at the end talking about vector indexes, okay? All right, guys, see ya. Remember, the 4:30 today is the Data Fusion talk.
I need something refreshing when I get finished manifesting. Too cold, a whole bowl like Smith & Wesson. One quart and my thoughts hip-hop related. Write a rhyme and my pen's intoxicated. Lyrics are quicker with a sip of malt liquor. Since I'm a city slicker, brain waves are quicker. Rhymes I create, rotate at a rate too quick to duplicate. Feel a breeze at a skate. Mics at Fahrenheit when I hold it real tight. When I'm in flight, then we ignite. Blood starts to boil, I heat up the party for you. Let my girl rub me and my mic down with oil. Records still turn with third degree burn for one man. I heat up your brain, give it a suntan. So just cool, let the temperature rise. To cool it off with same odds.